Father, again, we thank you for the opportunity of coming together and learning a little bit more about the Constitution. And Lord, I'm asking forgiveness for our country in the way that they are denigrating the Constitution and taking the morals out of our country. So today, Lord, I pray that this little group right here will become a very major factor in the Constitution being reinvigorated right here in Forsyth County. And I thank you for Ms. Trilby, who has put so much effort into doing this by bringing Earl here to teach us. And so, Lord, we do thank you for this opportunity. And it's in the precious name of Jesus, the risen Christ, our Lord, that we do thank you. And let us stand.
Because the founders have answers to nearly every problem we have in America today. That's an incredible statement, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And you don't realize that until you get in and look at what they said, which is what we're going to do today. And if you're like my students, I own and operate a charter high school in Mesa, Arizona, and I teach seniors government.
Amen.
And as soon as you start telling them these things and they start learning these things, you know what the first question is? Well, Mr. Taylor, this sounds so simple. Why are we doing it this way?
Exactly.
Then you have to tell them the rest of the story, which isn't that great. But I hope you'll thrill today with me as I have taught this for many years and never cease or never tire of doing it, because it is great. It's just wonderful to see people, young and old, light up with these concepts. So I'm so grateful that you're here. I know each person here had to give up something today. Saturdays are valuable. And I appreciate you making the sacrifice. And I particularly note that we have some young people here with us. Because you young people have a great challenge ahead of you. I suppose you know that. You're the ones that's going to help put it all back together again. And the rest of us might be still around to see how you do it. But as we begin, each of you, for example, should have a study guide in front of you. Each person have a study guide? You know, if you were just to sit here and listen to me, I think you'd find it interesting. But if that's all you did, guess how much you'd remember in a couple of weeks?
10%?
That's being very generous. People who do these kinds of studies say, you remember about 2 to 5% after 2 weeks. If you don't believe me, tell me what that great sermon was in church 2 weeks ago. Remember how great it was? Yeah, it was sure good. Tell me about it. Well, it was sure good. That's kind of the way we are, isn't it? And so students know if you want to remember things, what do you have to do? You got to take notes, right? Now, we're going to be imparting a lot of information to you today. We don't want anybody getting writer's cramp with all we're going to give you. And so have you noticed what we've given you in your study guides? All of your notes in beautiful sentence outline, all typed so you can read them when you get home. So 2 weeks from today, you'll say, let's see now, what was that point that was made? And you'll look back at your notes and kind of refresh your memories. Oh yeah, that's what it was. And people say if you do that way, you can remember up to 75% of what we talk about today. Aren't those the kind of Americans we need today?
Yes.
People who remember things, particularly lessons of history. And so that's why we do it this way. But have you noticed we haven't given you all of your notes? Have you noticed, what have we left?
You gotta fill in the blanks.
Little blanks. Yeah, you know what that's for? That's to keep you right with me as we move through this material. Over the years, it's the best way we have found to impart a lot of information in a short period of time. Kind of a programmed learning, if you would. So I hope each of you has something to write with, pen or pencil. Do we all have something to write with as we move? Okay. Now, how many of you have been to Boston? Okay. Usually in the East here, most everybody has. Let me ask you this. When you were in Boston last, or sometime, did you walk the Freedom Trail? How many of you walked the Freedom Trail of Boston? Okay, about 4 or 5 of us. We take our students there. We take them back east here every year for a week for a history tour. And every 2 years in October, and we'll be doing it again this October, we go to Boston. And we always walk the Freedom Trail. Freedom Trail is a red painted stripe on the sidewalk through old Boston. And there's about 15 or 16 different stops along the way. And it's a fun thing to do and very educational because you can review about 300 years of American history in about a half a day. And if any of you haven't done that, next time you're up there, be sure and walk the Freedom Trail. It's a self-guided tour. And one of the first places you come to, actually it is the first stop along the way after the Boston Common, is called the Old Granary Cemetery. Now, this is a cemetery whose headstones are weather-worn and dilapidated surrounded by high-rise buildings now. But as you go into that cemetery and you walk along the little trail, one of the first graves of note that you come to is the grave of John Hancock. Do you remember John Hancock?
Yes.
So you could tell some stories about him. Then you walk a little farther, and here's the grave of Paul Revere. You know about Paul Revere. Then you walk a little farther, and here's a whole family of headstones. This is the Goose family in colonial America. Anybody ever heard of the Goose family? And there's one particular person in that family. Her name is Mary Elizabeth Goose. You ever heard of her? Yes, you have. What? Mother Goose. There she is. I didn't know that was a real person. Somebody had to write those things we memorized, right? And then in the center of the cemetery is a big monument to Benjamin Franklin's parents. Ben Franklin was born there in Boston. He's buried in Philadelphia, but his parents are buried there. And then you go a little farther, and here's the grave of Samuel Adams, father of the American Revolution. And we could name a few others, James Otis and a few others, but this is just one stop on the Freedom Trail. You see what I'm talking about? Marvelous. And then you come out of the cemetery and you walk a little farther and you pass the old State House in downtown Boston where the Declaration of Independence was read and the bells rang and everybody cheered. That was a great day in Boston. And next to the old State House is a big round stone memorial almost in the middle of an intersection, marking the place of the Boston Massacre. Remember that? Where five young men were killed by British troops. They're buried in the old Granary Cemetery also. And then you walk a little farther, and now you're down into the financial district of Boston. What are financial districts? What are buildings like in the financial districts of big cities? Tall. Skyscrapers almost. And nestled among these huge buildings is a little church. It's called Old South. Old South Meeting House, as it was called then, was the largest meeting place in Boston in colonial days. Now it's dwarfed by these huge buildings. But I love to take my students in there because, among other things, there was a couple of exciting events that happened in Old South. And after the docent, our students are seated on the pews, and after the docent talks about the building and how the British took it over and made a writing stable out of it, and it was almost torn down, but it wasn't, and it was preserved and restored eventually. Then I say to my students, now I want to talk to you for a minute and remind you of two events that happened right here in this building. And one event is when Samuel Adams brought his young Sons of Liberty into that building on the evening of the 19th day and said, we cannot let those ships stay loaded down at the harbor, and that's only two blocks away. One more day. If we do, we'll lose. What's he talking about? Well, one of the means of protests against the British policies was that the longshoremen, the people who unloaded the ships in the ports, refused to unload British merchant ships. And most of the time, in Charleston and New York, some of these major ports, the ships would eventually be sent back to England with the cargo, but not in Boston. Governor Hutchinson, the king's governor, had a rule, and he said, if the ships are not unloaded within 20 days, my soldiers, the king's soldiers, will board the ships, unload the cargo, bring it on shore, and sell it for whatever they can get with the tax attached. 20 days. So this is the evening of the 19th day when Samuel Adams is in Old South with his young supporters. He says, we cannot let that happen. So what did they do? You know the story. Painted their faces and went down and unloaded the ships. Well, a little unconventional way, dumped it all into the bay. And you know what that did. But all that started right there in Old South. Then there's another event that happened several decades before. This is in 1746. And this is in the life of John Adams by Catherine Drinker Bowen. And John Adams tells this story because his father told him that in 1746, this was just before the beginning of the French and Indian War, you may remember, when the French were our enemies. And the French fleet had been given orders to come and burn the coastal cities of the colonists. Charleston was to be burned, New York was to be burned, Boston was to be burned. Well, what defense did we have? What defense did the colonists have against such a huge armada? Did we have a nice navy we could go out and sink ships? No. Did we have nice artillery that could launch and sink ships miles out? No. What was our defense? after all we could do, what was it? To proclaim a day of fasting and prayer and ask God for help.
Amen.
That happened many times in colonial days. Students today in most schools never even hear of those things. But so, it was a beautiful, clear day in Boston when the day had come that was set aside as a day of fasting and prayer. And they were asked to assemble in Old South, the largest meeting place in Boston. And it was the Reverend Thomas Prince whose turn it was to officiate that day. And so he welcomed the people as they came in, apparently standing room only. And he took to the podium. They used to let me stand on the podium to tell this story, but some bureaucracies got in the way. They won't let me do that anymore, but whatever. And he gets on the podium, and he welcomes the people, and he says, "Now let us pray." And he begins to pray. "Oh God, we need thy help. Sink those French frigates to the bottom of the sea, oh God," was his request. And the record says, quite a lengthy prayer going on and on, probably explaining to God the problem. As though you need to do that, right? But that's what you do when you're desperate, so that you know he knows you know what the problem is, right? And that's kind of what you do. And anyway, after a while, he pauses in his prayer because the room begin to darken. And the windows up above begin to rattle. And the bell up in the belfry begins to bong irregularly. And the sexton said later, "It wasn't me. I wasn't pulling that rope. No, that was the wind. Something was happening outside." And he pauses and he takes all this in. And he raises his hands again and then he says, "Oh God, we hear thee, we hear thee. Thou hast answered our prayer. Thou hast sunk those frigates to the bottom of the sea, O God." What did he have, a nice cell phone to let them know they're going down? I don't think so. He just felt like this was an answer to their prayer. And do you know, a little over a week later, they got word that on the very day they were assembled in Old South, a storm had suddenly arose out of the Atlantic and had destroyed that French fleet. Sunk nearly every one of them, the few that remained, killed the admiral, a few that remained, hobbled on back to the West Indies from whence they came. Boston had not been burned. New York had not been burned. Once again, the colonists were saved. What a great story. One of several dozen stories like that we could tell you. Documentable American history. And we are cheating our young people today when we don't tell them American history the way it really happened. As a matter of fact, you might be interested to know, there are suggestions in some states now in public schools to begin the teaching of American history after the Civil War. Because they say the history before that is irrelevant. Oh my goodness. Anyway. That's what we're faced with. And I can tell you some other stops along the Freedom Trail, but that's enough to suffice to make the point. I hope you think today that we're walking a Freedom Trail. We're walking a Freedom Trail with the founders. We're going to find out where they got their good ideas. We're going to find out how it was tough for them to blaze the trail for freedom. But it's exciting to hear their story, because as I said, they have answers. Answers to nearly every problem we have in America today. And so if you're ready to walk a freedom trail with the founders, let's get started. I want you to turn to page 5 in your study guide. And you know, as you study history, and as you study governments in the world, in world history, you kind of conclude that there are only two kinds of government after all is said and done. Now, these have technical names we could mention, but they're a little hard to remember, so we've given them very easy names to remember. We call them ruler's law and people's law. And those are your two blanks. just above the map. Rulers and peoples. Who do you think makes the law under ruler's law? Who would you say? The ruler, the dictator, the tyrant, right? Who makes the law or accepts the law under people's law? The people. And as you study history, you can kind of categorize governments into one of these two camps. Matter of fact, even when you're teaching American history and the administrations of different presidents, if you know about ruler's law and people's law, then you can say, oh, that's an element of ruler's law, what that president just did. See how you can do that? And when you teach young people this, and they begin to identify, well, that's ruler's law, or that's people's law, I'm telling you, that these young people are never the same. And so after Columbus came, what was the first major nation to make inroads into the New World? Remember this?
Spain.
What kind of law did the Spanish bring?
Ruler's law,
right? Heavy-handed ruler's law, no question. Then the Spanish were blunted by another nation. What nation blunted the Spanish?
The French.
What kind of law did the French bring? Ruler's law. You got one ruler's law ahead of another, leaving a nice little area on the East Coast for a different people with a different kind of law, at least written in their hearts. Who were these? These were the English, right? These were the English. And did you know that by the time the Declaration was written, there were about 3 million English colonists in America? That's your blank below the map there, 3 million. And as we said, they brought with them elements of people's law, which is your blank at the end, people's law. Well, where did they get this? Well, their early ancestors of the British were known, top of the next page, as Anglo-Saxons. Anglo-Saxons. These were people who came into Britain about 450 AD, set up a wonderful system of government that lasted nearly 600 years until that tragic hook date of history, 1066. Who can tell us what happened in 1066?
Norman Conquest.
The Norman Conquest. William the Conqueror came over, conquered the Saxon people, and corrupted their form of government, which is your blank for letter B, corrupted. Corrupted. And in letter C is an interesting quote from Jefferson, I won't take time to read it, describing the different system that the Normans set up. So you have this constant battle between the Saxon people and the Norman kings. The Saxon people trying to get their rights back from the Norman kings. We have novels written about this time period, the struggle of the Saxons. Can you name some novels that we've all read or heard about? Struggle of the Saxons against King John and so forth. That's a little north.
Robin Hood.
Right? Robin Hood. Ivanhoe. Read Ivanhoe? These are classic descriptions of the struggles of the Saxon people. And about 150 years into this, 1215, the Saxon people said, maybe we need to take a big chart and write some of our rights down on it and take it to the king so he'll remember our rights. See, this is one of the problems with Anglo-Saxon law. It wasn't written down. So guess what our founders learned from that?
Write it down.
If you want to preserve your rights, one of the best ways to do it is to write it down. Write it down. Can somebody tell me about how many nations are in the world today? Changes every year, so just about. What's a good round figure?
Around 200.
Can you guess today how many of those 200 nations have actual written constitutions? What would you guess?
50, 30.
Do I hear? You'll be as surprised as I was. At last count that I heard, 125. Can you guess which of those 125 is the oldest written constitution?
British.
Ours. British still doesn't even have a written constitution. England doesn't. Ours, the United States, one of the youngest countries, has the oldest written constitution. Why? because this was something new the founders came up with. If you want to preserve it, write it down. Okay? So what did they call this big chart in 1215? What did they call that?
Magna Carta.
Magna Carta, which is your blank for letter D. Magna Carta. Well, as you know, King John didn't honor it, really. And a little later that century, they said, maybe we need to get some of our best people and send them up to be with the king as he administers the government to remind the king of the rights of the people. This is the first parliament. Parliament, that's your blank for letter E. P-A-R-L-I-A-M-E-N-T. Parliament in 1264. Well, that's about the way things stayed for several generations. We went through the Reformation period and so forth. And then in letter F in the 1600s, there was a man named Sir Edward Cook, pronounced Cook, spelt Coke. Sir Edward Cook, he was an English judge. And in his decisions, later in his life, he said, you know, really, human rights belong to all freemen. That's your blank at the end, freemen. Not just the nobles, and not just the upper class, but to all freemen. Human rights belong to all freemen. And he began writing about the equality of mankind. Our founding fathers loved to read Sir Edward Cook on his doctrine of equality of rights. And letter G, in 1628, Charles I was so bad, Parliament forced him to sign, here's another document, the Petition of Rights. Petition of Rights. Did Charles I honor it? Remember what happened to Charles I? Anybody remember this?
He lost his head.
He did. They convicted him of treason and beheaded him. These were dangerous times for British kings. And he was followed by Charles II, and he was followed by James II, and he was so bad, they threw him over in what was called the Glorious Revolution and said, nobody can ascend to the throne of England unless they sign, here's another document, letter H, the English Bill of Rights. Bill of Rights. Do you see what's happening here, folks? After they lose their rights in 1066, over centuries, they pass petitions, they have documents, so what's struggling to get their rights back for centuries. And the question is, did they ever really do it? Fully? No, after all that time. So what did they eventually have to do, some of them? They had to go to a new land, right? Go to a new land. I have some bad news for us today.
There's no place to go.
No.
Yeah, if we find ourselves in that position, where is there to go?
Nowhere.
There's no new land. We're here. How many of us have roots in England? You know your family roots? Oh, look at this. Yeah, most of it. Okay. Have you ever thought about your ancestors who lived there during this time? What side they were on? Of course, they were on the right side, right? They're your relatives. And the struggles that they went through. The torture, the imprisonment, the deprivations, these were rough times. Going through all that to eventually have their posterity come to America and enjoy the blessings of freedom. I don't know about you, but I think we owe them a debt of gratitude. I'm not sure what we did to deserve what we have. But I'm glad I live now and not back then. But they were people. They had yearnings for peace, prosperity, and freedom. And they didn't have it. Well, let me ask you this question. If they could speak to us today, what would be their counsel?
Behead.
Revolt.
I think they would have something to say to us. At least they would say, I think, don't let happen to you what happened to us. Because if you do, it is extremely difficult to recover. I think that's what they would say. Well, so here we are. With history, very clear what happens when people lose their freedom and their rights. So at least we need to know their story. And so hopefully we can prevent it from happening totally to us. So let's talk about the English experience here in America. Somebody tell me the first permanent English settlement in America traditionally.
Jamestown.
Yeah, in what year?
1607.
1607, right there in letter B, 1607. Did you know that when they were planning to come, of course they had to be financed, and they were financed by a group of London businessmen who said to them, now when you get over there, we've tried it a couple of times and it just hasn't worked. So when you get over there, we want you to agree to follow certain rules, and here are the rules. Number one, there will be no private property. We don't want people just going out on their own, and you'll live in a commune. Everybody will own everything in common, and you'll have a leader, and he will assign you your tasks so that everybody will know exactly what to do, and everybody will survive. What do you think? You don't like that system? What does that sound like?
Social.
Yeah, that's a communistic form of government. That's your blank, communism. Secular communism. No private property, do what you're told. Does anybody know what happened to Jamestown? It almost died out. Didn't quite, that's why it's the first permanent, but it almost did. And if they hadn't have broken out of that system, they would have died off. Now we know a whole lot more about the next major colony that came in 1620. These were the Pilgrims, right? These were the Pilgrims. Do you know that they were financed by the same kind of business people in England who gave them the same rules? You'll no private property, you'll have a leader, and he'll assign you your task, but you can make these rules work because you're more committed Christians. And Christians believe in working together and having all things in common, and you know, you can make these kind of a Christian communism. That's your blank Christian, if there ever was such a thing. Now, you had a question or a comment, sir?
Just answer. Thank you.
Okay. Well, and so they came over under that agreement, and you remember one of their leaders was Governor William Bradford. Governor Bradford is known as the father of American history, because he took meticulous notes. And you can read this story that I'm going to tell you in The History of Plymouth Plantation by William Bradford. So he says, we came over and I assigned the tasks. You know, there were fields to cultivate, food to cook, children to tend, clothes to wash, all of this stuff. And he says, I assigned it all out and then I said, now let's go to work. I've noticed here, I've met some of you this morning before we started. And I see we have some experienced moms among us. Mom, how did that work for you? I know you made the chore chart, right? Uh-huh. So, and I know what you were thinking when you made it. This is going to be so nice. Everybody's going to have their assignment. No more complaining, no more contention. Mom, how did that work? Works for a few days, doesn't it? Then all of a sudden you get excuses, right? And doesn't matter what the excuse is. Well, I forgot, or I didn't have time, or no fair, I'm doing more work than she is, or whatever. And do you know that Bradford said the same thing was happening in Plymouth? People started giving excuses about why they couldn't work. And but since everything was in common, they got the same reward at the end. Sound familiar? And it wasn't working. And the people were starving. You know the first few years of Plymouth, it was tough. And Bradford finally gets them all together, all the men, that is, and he says, we came over here to get away from tyranny. And you're making me a tyrant. Because I have to make you do the work. I'm not going to be a tyrant anymore. So you know what he did? He divided up all the land by the size of families. Divided up everything, probably the seed, corn, the tools, divided up everything. And then he said, in effect, brethren, from here on out, it's root hog or die. We're going to die anyway. So good luck. He goes out into his field the next season to do his work. Can hardly believe what he sees. And he writes about it. We're at the top of page 8 next to the little picture there of the restored village of Plymouth. How many of you have been there, restored village of Plymouth? Okay. And he writes this. He says, this had very good success, this new system, for it made all hands very industrious. So as much more corn was planted than otherwise would have been. Now this is Old English. This is before Webster, right? The women now went willingly into the field and took their little ones with them to set corn, which before would allege weakness and inability, whom to have compelled would have been thought great tyranny and oppression. What's he saying here? You know this. You know human nature. What's he saying here? What was happening? Yes. People knew that if it was theirs, and they could enjoy the blessings of their harvest themselves and do what they wanted to with it, that most people will work extremely hard and get the whole family to work and so forth if you knew that there's an incentive. And that's what was happening. This is a great story. And it happened over 400 years ago. When I tell this to some college students, sometimes I'm invited to speak to some college students in Arizona. And I always ask them this question after I explain this. Who are some of the first people in modern times, in history, it's usually after 1500, so this is modern time, to try communism? Well, we were. America. In Jamestown. And what did we find out? It's a failure formula. What are we doing? We're acting like nobody ever heard of that before, ever tried that before, because we seem to be doing some of those same things. Interesting. Yes, sir?
So if self-interest is what motivates people to do what's good for society, and in the communal society, concern for your neighbors and the civil government at large is not enough motivation to work hard in the fields, is that an acknowledgement of selfishness in human nature? And does that mean that we have to, or the founders had to come up with a government that played off of that to make your own self-interest a motivator?
Yeah, it usually stems from the fact that while a lot of the things that incentivize people is self-interest, they soon realize that if they don't do something for the benefit of other people, that self-interest would be very limiting. So how do you benefit other people? You make a better product. You make it cheaper. You make more of a variety. See, that benefits the whole. Adam Smith called this the invisible hand. Yes, it's driven sometimes by the desire of a person to succeed and to have more. But in a community, that usually translates, not always, but it usually translates into the benefit of the society. So let it be. As long as the people's rights are protected against fraud and so forth and so on. See that? Yeah.
I think the principle is the same, but I think that the difference between a regular secular community as a Christian community is the Christian community with God in their heart. They're willing to share, willing to help. And
yes.
With the secular, it's totally selfish.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Yeah, the incentive of ownership was a big carrot. But I think the stick played a big part of that, too, in the sense that they knew they weren't going to get the corn and the crops from the other people, that this family had to make it on their own. Otherwise, you were going to perish and they were all going to survive.
Yeah.
I don't think we should downplay the stick part of that.
Thank you. We take our students there after we visit Boston, which we'll do again in October. And we go into this little recreated village. And I tell the students, I say, now you look for Governor Bradford. because he's there, and he usually is, and you ask him to tell you the story of how he changed the system. Now, he can tell it better than I can. And to see these students all gathered around Governor Bradford, because they have people there who are in costume and in character. That's a marvelous place. If you're ever up there, just an hour and a half drive south of Boston in Plymouth. And do you see the little hut there, the first hut on the left of that little trail? That's the hut of Stephen Hopkins, who was a Mayflower passenger. And I was in that little hut with a few of my students a few years ago. And Mrs. Hopkins was making, well, what she called food. I'm not sure what it was, but anyway, she said that. Little fire smoke going up through the thatched roof, and she was explaining it. One of my students said, "Mrs. Hopkins, may I take your picture?" And Mrs. Hopkins looked at her, and she looked at her water pitcher on the mantle. She looked back at my student and said, "What do you want with my pitcher?" See, they're in character. You ask them any question after 1638, they don't know what you're talking about, let alone a picture or a camera. They don't know anything about that. Isn't that interesting? Great place to visit. Let's talk a little bit about Jamestown. Let me ask you this. When they came to Jamestown, what were they using to plow their fields with? Do you know this in history? Just a what?
A stick
plow, a little piece of metal maybe on the end, pulled behind the ox. About the way people had been plowing their fields for over 5,000 years. What was their transportation like? Animal power, ox carts, walking. Some of the ships weren't even as large as some of the ancient ships. About the way people had been getting around for over 5,000 years, right? How were they making their cloth? Hand loom. About the way people have been doing it for over 5,000 years. What are we saying here, folks? Up until Jamestown, there just hadn't been much human progress made. All of a sudden, you're in a place where you can set the human spirit free, where you can start trying things. And they, as we've described to you, they tried things, and they decided some things work and some things don't work. So you got all this, this is a trial and error. From Jamestown to 1607 until the Constitution was written in what year? Constitution
1787.
Now where's my math majors here? How many years is that? 1607 to 1787?
180 years.
180 years. I like to call that 180 years of trial and error. Where they tried some things, like we've told you. Some things worked and some things didn't work. And the things that didn't work, they said, and they wrote it down to us. Don't ever do that. And some things did work. Oh, do this, do this. Their formula is absolutely incredible. So when they came, here's another thing you might be interested in. I'll just mention this. Since it's the season, they said, and this is in their writings, never let the government tax people based on their income. They wrote that? Yes, they did. Matter of fact, they felt so strongly about that, they put a prohibition of that kind of a tax right into the Constitution. Did you know that? I'll show you that this afternoon. What are we doing? All of a sudden, somebody comes along around 1913, this is the progressive era, you know, and says, here's a new way to raise money. It's not a new way. It's not a new idea. It's only a bad old idea. But if you don't read the founders, you'd never know. So we kind of fall for this stuff, if you notice that.
They also said not to let a private bank control the issuance of your currency.
That's another thing they wrote. Incredible. Well, so here we are. And uh, when you write it down in 1787, the principles that work, what happened? You solidify a written constitution. Oh my goodness. We went from ox carts in 1787. In less than 200 years, where were we? Walking on the moon. In other words, we went farther in 200 years than mankind had gone in over 5,000 years before. In other words, we say in those 200 years, we made a 5,000 year leap. And you say, how in the world was this possible? Well, you just discover things that work, principles that work, put them in writing, in play, and let the people be free, and you'll see it. This is an incredible miracle that happened.
That leads to patent law, intellectual property rights.
Absolutely, absolutely. I hope you love principles in your life. I'm not necessarily talking about P-A-L-S, I'm talking about P-L-E-S, right? For example, if I were to say to you, 4 times 4 is 16, would you all agree with that here in Forsyth County? Yeah, see, boy, that was quick. I didn't see anybody figure that out. How did you know that? Why did you know that just like that?
Memorization.
Yeah, somebody back in, when was it? Back in the second grade, whatever it was, said if you memorize these little principles, these little facts, it'll be a blessing to you your whole life. Has it been? Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, don't you have to think? I could stand up here and try to convince you that 4 times 4 is 13. I don't think I could do that, because you know it. 8 times 8 is 64. With me? 12 times 12 is 144. See how that works? 13 times 13 is 169. What happened here?
We didn't memorize that.
We went beyond 12.
You can figure it out if you can. It is 160. Now, hey, folks, I won't lie to you. I'm from out of town. I teach Sunday school. I do. I won't lie to you. Oh, okay, 169. That's nice. 18 times 18 is 324. It is. Would you believe me? I told you I'd never lie to you, and I teach Sunday school.
You're not a politician.
No, I'm not a politician.
Good, you won't lie to me.
Okay, see? It is. It's 324, if any of you just figured it out. 39 times 39 is 2581. If I tell you it's true, would you believe me? Thank you. You will? Well, I appreciate the confidence.
40,
40, 16. Yeah, see, he knows a quick way of doing it.
About the square root of -1.
Yeah, there you go. Some of us are wondering what's he talking about. Actually, that's over 1,000 off. But if you didn't memorize your 39s, you really wouldn't know that right off unless you knew a quick way. But see, it kind of sounded good when I initially said it, didn't it? 39 times 39, 9 times 9 is 81. He says 2581. Sounds good. Sounds good. I ask you folks, is this not what's happening in legislative halls all over this land?
Yes.
Where somebody comes along and, you know, they'll never lie to us, and they kind of seem like, you know, they may even teach Sunday school, whatever, and they make a proposal. And it sounds kind of good because it's going to take care of this group of people, it's going to take care of this group of people, you know, going to bail out this business, and it's going to do this, going to do this. And we all want to help people. And so some of us just kind of say, oh, okay. And we don't know the principles. And if you don't know the principles, you can be snookered. Even good people can be fooled. And I think most people are good. But if you don't know the principles, you can be fooled. I think that's what's happened.
What did you say 39 times 39
is? I said 2581.
Wrong. Unless I calculated.
See there? Oh, check me out. That's good. And that's what we should do when we don't know the immediate answer. Check it out. Well, We call those little things multiplication tables, little principles of mathematics. How would you like a set of principles for government that you could memorize just like you memorize the multiplication table? So when somebody comes along with some grandiose proposal, you can immediately say whether it's right or wrong, true or false, good or bad. Wouldn't that be great? Actually, you have it right there on your little card. All of you have this little card? This is our business card. Now you know what the title means, the 5,000-year lease, right? And all of our information is on there. You turn over on the back, and there you have the principles of liberty that the founders said. Any people, not just Americans, any people who subscribe to these principles will have freedom, prosperity, and peace. We're going around this nation asking people to memorize these, just like you memorize the multiplication table, promising you, if you do, a great vision of incredible simplicity will open up to you in this messy field we call politics. And it's amazing what will happen if you know the principles. Let's just give you an example. Look at number one. The only reliable basis for sound government and just human relations is natural law. Natural law? You go out here to somebody on the street and ask them about natural law, they'll look at you like, what? You know what you're talking about. Most Americans have never studied natural law. Did you know you couldn't get out of Princeton or Harvard in the days of the founders without being very conversant with natural law? What is natural law?
God's law.
It's the law of the Creator. It's the law of nature and of nature's God. And John Locke wrote about it. Jefferson wrote about it. Cicero of ancient Rome wrote about it. Natural law. Blackstone wrote about it. You know William Blackstone? The author of the commentaries on the English law. Blackstone's writings were the legal Bible for every attorney for the first 100 years of this country. Abraham Lincoln carried the Bible in one hand and Blackstone in the other. And I love William Blackstone's discussion of natural law. He says, and I'm paraphrasing several pages, but he says, natural law really is the order in which the Creator made everything to work properly. It's truth. It's the way things are. And he says there's two great divisions of natural law. He called the first one cosmic law. What's that? That's scientific law. These are laws that if you can discover and put them to use, what can you have? What can you have? Electricity, lights. Cell phones, computers, jet airplanes, if you discover the laws and put them to use properly. He called this cosmic law. It's a law of nature, laws of nature, right? But he said, don't forget about the other part of the laws of nature that are just as important, if not more so. And he called these revealed laws for human happiness. What would those be? These are laws that the Creator gave us right from the beginning. He didn't leave us to fumble around and discover this on our own. He said, if you want to be happy and have a happy society, tell me what he said. Don't
kill.
That doesn't lead to happiness. Don't steal. Don't commit adultery. Don't lie. Don't covet your neighbor's property. Go out and earn your own. It's the gospel of work. And a few others. And Blackstone is saying these are just as much part of natural law for the happiness of man as any other scientific law. Isn't that interesting? This is all natural law. Wow. So the founders said, if you establish a government based on natural law, it will succeed. If you establish a government that says, well, we're going to, in our government, we're not going to let people own private property. We're not going to let them enjoy the benefits of their labors. As soon as they produce, we're going to take things from them and redistribute it. You've heard that word before. And redistribute it to everybody. What can you say if you know the principles? What can you say right off? It will fail. Has it?
Yes.
Yes, every time. See that? I tell you, when you can get, and we spend a lot of time talking about these principles in my class, one whole semester, because this is our textbook for the first semester, 5,000 year lead, maybe some of you read it. It's a chapter on each of these principles, and where they got these ideas. The quotes I've given you, some of them are in here. And when you can teach young people natural law, oh my goodness, all of a sudden a whole new arena opens up to them, and they start seeing natural law everywhere, or the violation of it.
Homosexual marriage.
Yeah, and they'll say, that's not natural law. This is amazing. I feel so strongly we need to teach our young people some of these basic truths. And they're smart enough because they see it. They see the hypocrisy. One of the things about young people that I've noticed, I'm talking about 16, 17, 18-year-olds that I teach, they see hypocrisy real quickly. And if you teach them correct principles, and the first thing you say, how come we're not trying? How come we're not doing that, Mr. Taylor? It sounds so logical. Thank you.
It's self-evident.
Somebody had a yes, sir.
So where does can an atheist support the Tea Party principles, or is a fundamental belief in God, if not the Christian God, then just a deity in general, a core requirement of following these principles?
Well, the founders said, and of course you can go with principle number two, a free people cannot survive as a republic unless they remain virtuous and morally strong. And look at number four. Without religion, the government of a free people cannot be maintained. I mean, this was so indelibly impressed into the founders. They knew this. They knew that you could have the best government you could ever have, but if you don't have virtue among the people, which is generated by a system of morality and religion, it will not hold. Now, they were very tolerant. And that's the beautiful thing about Christianity. It's very tolerant, more than any other religion. And so we welcome people who haven't quite come to that conclusion yet, whether they're atheists or agnostics, whatever. But you cannot allow their philosophy to govern you, right, because it will not hold. That was their belief.
That's exactly where we are today.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
May I ask a question?
Absolutely.
Are you going to be, in this day, are you going to cover how we can put natural law back into our country?
Yes, to a certain point. We're teaching principles here, and we'll use some examples, mostly this afternoon, about our Constitution and how it should be and what we need to do to restore it. And if I don't, you can be sure and ask me about it.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyway, yes, sir.
Mr. Taylor, I'm Don McDaniel. I'm a retired Army chaplain. And I sort of see number four, without religion or the Bible, I see the Bible as checks and balances against what, unfortunately, the federal and sometimes the state governments are doing now.
Because Washington said in his farewell address, because I'm sure you have heard of somebody who says, well, I can be a moral person, I don't need religion. We've all heard people say that. And Washington, in his farewell address to the nation, said, be very careful when somebody claims you can have morality without religion. He says, religion and morality are indispensable supports to our republic. What are the indispensable supports to this building? Walls, the pillars, you take them away. What is the problem with somebody claiming they can be moral without religion? What's the first question that I ask is, well, whose morality do you follow?
Where do you get the morality?
And of course, their answer is, well, my own. And then I say, well, what's that? And they say, well, it's whatever the situation at the time demands. What does religion give to morality? This is all Washington. What does it give to morality?
Stability,
a system, a foundation, right? It gives it a basis.
Content and structure.
Content, very good. But Washington doesn't stop there. Listen to this. He says, be careful when somebody comes to you, this is in his farewell address, in the name of refined education, and says you don't need religion. Well, that's kind of interesting. Father of our country. Somebody had it. Yes?
I think you can, too evident, if you look at the government of Cuba and the government in China, you know, government makes the rules. There's no free people there. Yeah. And if you do something wrong in the morning, in the evening, you'll be gone. Yeah. You know, there's no government of free people.
There is so much evidence of the truthfulness of what these principles are teaching that it shouldn't even be a question anymore. But who studies history? Who reads the founders?
So does the belief in natural law require faith, or is there empirical and historical evidence to prove that it exists and it is the best system?
Well, as I say to my students, what if the legislature of Arizona in Phoenix should pass a law saying there's no more gravity in Arizona? There isn't?
It'll boost their tourist trade.
Well, this is exciting. I don't know if you ever have any dreams where you're weightless. I don't know why we have some of those, but, you know, and so we're going to get on a real tall building because the legislature says there's no more gravity. We're going to try it out. You first. And you just go back to the simple declaration. If it's against natural law, it will fail. And the founder said, if it's against natural law, which is God's law, the order in which he created everything to work properly, which includes gravity and so forth, if a legislature passes that kind of a law, it is null and void from the beginning. It is no law.
Wow, that's revolutionary. I've read this before.
That quote's in here from the founders. So,
Mr. Taylor, we need to introduce the principle of gravity on a high building of 20 stories to atheists.
Well,
what about this?
We're going to teach you first. But once again, folks, we're tolerant. Because we're all human. We don't make mistakes. But don't let these philosophies rule us. And govern us. That's the key. So, okay, this is 2013. Next year's an election year again. Comes up often, doesn't it? Somebody's running for office here in Georgia, maybe running for Congress. And you're out in the summertime working in your garden, and your neighbor comes up to you and says, hey, what do you think about the proposal that old so-and-so made the other day who's running for Congress? And you'll put down your hoe, and this is after you've memorized these, right? And you'll say, let me tell you a principle behind that. And you'll quote him a principle that you've memorized, maybe number seven on your card. You say, you know, the proper role of government is to protect equal rights, not provide equal things. And you'll look at him and you'll say, now that's why that program is dangerous. Because it violates one of the most basic principles of good government. Or you might be able to say, that's why, that's right on. It's right in line with the principle of good government. You know what your neighbor will do? He'll look at you and say, Wow. You're smart. Where did you learn that?
Well, you know, I just did a little reading, a little memorizing.
So you have to be real humble when you know this much. This is not much to know. But it's more than most people know. And all of a sudden, you become a teacher. Folks, we need thousands of teachers of correct principles. And everybody can do it in your own way. Your family, your neighbors, people you worship with. Everybody can do it if you first know the principles. And you become a person that people turn to for advice. And they'll call you up the night before the election. And they'll say, you know, there's a lot of issues and a lot of candidates on the ballot. I haven't taken the time to study, but I know you have. And not that I'll agree with you on all of them, but just kind of tell me what you think. All of a sudden, you become a person of influence. We need that. Millions of people doing that. And it will thrill you. So, will you take that challenge, folks? Memorize these. Next time I come to Forsyth County, I hope. Have a little quiz? No, we won't. But it will do wonders for you if you memorize these. We have a few of these back there. If you want to pick up a few more, please do so. Yes, sir.
Can we do we have your permission to enlarge and reproduce these?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Whatever we can do to get the word out. As a matter of fact, if you haven't read this book, I would highly recommend you to do it. It says 1995 on it. You can buy it back there for $10. Or if you buy 10 of them, $5 a piece. I hope you can see we're not trying to make money. We want to spread the message of freedom. And this is one of those books that will thrill you. Very easy reading. And you'll see where the founders got these great ideas. So if you'll help us do that, that's wonderful. Well, let's go on here. On page 8, the next major group that came were the Puritans, and that's your blank. They founded Boston, as you may remember, in 1630. And they set up a pretty strict enclave there in Boston, and eventually some families decided to leave and form their own. And so you remember the families of Anne Hutchinson and Roger Williams, they left and formed the colony of Rhode Island. And then in letter B, Reverend Thomas Hooker, that's your blank, Hooker, he left, actually with some of my relatives, the Taylors, and founded the colony of Connecticut on the Connecticut River. And when Reverend Hooker established the colonies, we're talking about Hartford, Windsor, Wethersfield, right around there, he said, you know what we need? We need to have a written plan of government. Well, what is that? What is a written plan of government? What do we call it?
Constitution.
And so he wrote what he called the Fundamental Orders of Connecticut. You can actually read it today, Fundamental Orders of Connecticut. So we attribute to Reverend Hooker the honor of having the first written constitution in America. And that's your blank at the bottom. But Reverend Hooker didn't stop there. He said where he got his good information for his Constitution. And being a reverend, where would you think he would say? The Bible. But he didn't stop there. He said, I got a lot of my information from the first chapter of the book of Deuteronomy. You read the first chapter of the book of Deuteronomy lately? You know, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, Numbers, those are, you know, may not be their favorite books to read in the Bible, but when I heard that from Reverend Hooker's writings, I went back and reread the first chapter of the book of Deuteronomy. And as you know, Deuteronomy means repetition of the law. This is Moses explaining near the end of his presence there with the Israelites, what God had done for them over those many years. And he was telling them how he set up the government of Israel based on God's law and principles of good government. I went back there, this is after I had memorized these, and read the first chapter of the book of Deuteronomy. I thought, oh my goodness. I mean, I had read it before,
But does that happen when you read the good book and you get a little more knowledge, a little more experience, and all of a sudden you read it again and it just kind of, yeah. And some of these are in that first chapter. And Reverend Hooker is saying, fundamental orders of Connecticut, based on these principles. Anyway, so I just recommend that to you. Let's talk about what the founders thought they were doing here in America. They had a sense of divine mission, your blank top of page 9, mission. They felt like there was a special reason for them to be here. This was not just another nation to start. And this is in their writings, and it will thrill you as you sense this. For example, letter A, Professor Cherry wrote, the belief that America had been providentially chosen for a special destiny has deep roots in the American past. Destiny is your blank. This is why, even though we have our foot stuck in the mud right now in this country, I believe with the founders, there's great days ahead.
Amen.
It may have to be after we go through some painstaking cleansing. When this whole thing collapses. But with the founders and their vision is explained in these books, in their writings. I can't emphasize that enough. They felt like America would not just wind up on the ash heap of history like other nations have. So, special destiny. Letter B, geographically, the founders felt that what they were doing would eventually cover all of North America. Did you know that they wanted Canada to become the 14th state? Yeah.
Yes.
They felt like eventually Mexico would come in.
Oh, it did. It did.
I knew that. Legally. Okay. In other words, this was not just a little colonial thing. No. This is big. Yeah. It will spread. So, letter C, as far as population was concerned, John Adams said, and by the way, he said this when there were about 5 million people in the colonies. He said, I think one day we will have at least 200 to 300 million freemen. Well, where are we? What was the last count?
370.
A little over 300, right? See, we're right there where he said. This is great vision. Letter D, the founders did not consider themselves a master race, but master servants. Now, I know you've probably heard with me a number of myths about the founders. You've heard probably how immoral some of them were. You probably have heard about their ideas of developing a capitalistic system to protect their own wealth, those greedy people. Matter of fact, there's a whole history book used in colleges written about that. And you may have heard that they thought they were a superior race. I'm telling you, if you read the founders themselves, you don't read that stuff. If you read what other people have written about them, yeah, that's where you get it. Mostly from people who don't want you to believe what they wrote. Stay with their words. Stay with their writings. It will thrill you. And you'll have the pure understanding of what they were all about. Look at the quote there next to the picture of John Adams. He said, I always consider the settlement of America with reverence and wonder as the opening of a grand scene and design in providence for the illumination of the ignorant and the emancipation of the slavish part of mankind where? All over the earth. This is not just a little America thing. Every nation, every people who want freedom, prosperity, and peace, if they will abide principles that we know will work, can have it. Just like we do. This is a great concept. So, all right, let's talk a little bit about 1776. Wasn't that a great year in American history? I mean, a declaration was written and the bells rang, and boy, that was just a great year, wasn't it?
Unless you've read David McCulloch's book, 1776, and you realize that's one of the worst years in American history. Well, it really was. A lot of terrible things happened. And it was particularly difficult for Thomas Jefferson. Difficult is your blank there. Why was it difficult for him? Well, a daughter had recently died. You know, Jefferson had six children, one boy and five girls. And the boy and three girls died in infancy. Another girl died as she reached maturity, and only one lived to give him posterity. So, and a daughter had recently died by this time. His wife was ill. His mother died that year. And these family issues, along with some other things, caused Jefferson to contract migraine headaches for several weeks. Never had a migraine, so I can't relate to that. But understand it's not fun. And he was particularly worried about Virginia. Did you know that Jefferson actually felt like one day they would be free from the tyranny of England? But he said, you know, it's one thing to be united against King George, but once we're free, there's not one state that knows what to do with freedom. Not one. And if you don't know what to do with freedom, it can be pretty rough. You know, young person says, well, just go to get out of here. There's too many rules, and they can launch out on their own. All of a sudden, what do they find out?
They have the freedom to fail.
It's pretty rough. What looks real good about that time? Back home, right? And Jefferson knew that states and groups of people act just like individuals do. If you don't know what to do with freedom, it can be rough. And so he just kind of took it upon himself to help Virginia lead the way, because Virginia was the biggest state. People looked to Virginia for an example. So that was just kind of almost a self-appointed mission for Jefferson. And so, under letter E, he wrote three constitutional drafts for Virginia in 5 weeks. Ever try to write a constitution when you didn't have one to go by? Well, he did. He wrote three of them in 5 weeks. And Virginia kept saying no, no, no to most of them. And he kept telling him, you've got to get rid of the weaknesses in your system if you're going to be free. Well, what were some of those weaknesses? Letter A, slavery. Says you got to get rid of it. Now, why does that sound a little, what should we say, ironic for Jefferson to be saying that?
He had slaves.
He had slaves. And before you jump on the anti-Jefferson bandwagon for having slaves, we need to understand the context of the times. First of all, where did Jefferson get the slaves he had? Inherited them from his father and his father-in-law. And that was an interesting, and did you know that in Virginia at this time, it was illegal to free slaves? Because they didn't want these people just having no place to be. It was legal when Washington did it, when he died. But when Jefferson died, up to that point, it was illegal. So what do you do? And one of my students' favorite places to visit when we come back here is Monticello. If you've been there, you see where Jefferson, how he took care of his people. They didn't want to leave. What would they do? This was a tough situation, but Jefferson said, you've got to get rid of this legislatively. Virginia rejected that, said no, no. Okay? Look at the next two, primogeniture and entailed estates. What does that have to do with it? Well, this has to do with property ownership. This is where, when the father dies, all of the property will go to the oldest son, which is your blank, no matter how competent or incompetent he might be. We have movies of this nowadays, this kind of thing, classic movies built on these concepts. Do you remember some of these? Pride and Prejudice, Sense and Sensibility. See, the only girls in the family, these are English movies, when the father dies, all of the
property goes to an uncle or a nephew, and all the girls are left out. See, this maintains the feudal system. Jefferson said, you must, in a free people, let people do with their property what they will. Don't make this artificial restriction on them. Isn't that interesting? And the official state church was left in power. Jefferson says, we must encourage religion equally, but not favor one church over another by making it the official church. Virginia says, oh, but we love our Anglican church. You couldn't hold certain public offices in Virginia unless you were members of the Church of England. Jefferson says, that's not right. So they rejected his see what's happening here? And letter E, the people were taxed to support the official church, even if they weren't members of it. Jefferson says, you can't do that. What a great pioneer. He didn't get his way at first. He kept working, got a lot of the things done, never did get it all. But anyway, Jefferson, what a great pioneer. When you're frustrated because you don't get your way, just remember Jefferson. It took him years to get most of it. Yes, sir.
What, since Thomas Jefferson is being covered here at this point, I have to ask, what were his views on slavery? And did he believe that African slaves were entitled to literal freedom under these principles of liberty?
Yes, he did. But he knew the history of it. He knew that this was such an ingrained thing in the culture that it had to be done the right way. You can't just free them because then other people wouldn't respect the same thing. It must be done legislatively. He's the one that literally believed all men are created equal. He wrote it. Yeah.
But he also freed his slaves.
Actually, he didn't.
On his will.
Because it was illegal to do that.
In his will, he freed them all. Did he not?
I think you're thinking of Washington did.
Okay.
Jefferson did. Because it was against the law to do that at that time. So, but these are tough issues. They were tough issues. We just need to have an understanding. Folks, maybe I can just mention this. We have three books back there, the real Thomas Jefferson, the real Benjamin Franklin, the real George Washington. I love these books. Why do we need more books on these? Well, maybe you notice, even though there's dozens of books on these men, most books are written from a particular perspective. And so we said, we need to tell their story straight up, as straight up as we can tell. Well, who's best to tell their story?
They are.
So the first half of these books, in this case Jefferson, is his life story, mostly in his own words. It will thrill you. And some of these myths you've heard about Jefferson, they're all here and dispelled. And then the last part of these books, the last half, timeless treasures from, in this case, Thomas Jefferson. These are quotes from his writings that we have picked out and thought to be the most important, given them headings, topics, alphabetized them, so you can look up and you can see, okay, what did Jefferson say about the origin of the banjo? Well, there it is. What is he? Oh, here we are. What does he say about banks? I could read you this and you would have thought he wrote that today.
Read it.
Because he describes exactly what would happen if you turn your money system over to private interests, which is what we've done.
Your children will wake up bankrupt in the continent that
their fathers purchased with their blood. You know that quote, very good. And he wrote it 200 years ago.
Wow.
Anyway. I mean, it just goes on and on, and his quote, just masterful. So, and it deals with his things about slavery, what he felt about Christianity. You've heard Jefferson's an atheist or whatever. You just read these. You don't. Where in the world do people get that if they read this? So, anyway, you can buy them back there individually, or you can buy them all three for $40. I just encourage you to stay with the founder's writings. It will surrender. Did you have a comment, sir?
Didn't he and Washington have some sort of an agreement between them that they would prepare their slaves for freedom by teaching them?
Yep. Jefferson, not only did he teach his slaves and wanted to prepare them, he was a great one to teach his daughters when it wasn't popular to teach daughters. He said, I want to train my daughters so that when they get to be mothers, they can teach their children. I mean, it goes on and on. Wonderful. Jefferson. Okay. We're happy to have State Senator Jack Murphy here with us for a while. Why don't you stand up?
Thank you. Hello. I've been reading through this. You know, the great thing is that you're doing this and the audience is here today. I wished it was a lot bigger, but it'd be great if we could get this taught in our public schools.
Let's do it.
I mean, it's a valuable lesson. And I was just looking at the map in here about the government-owned land out west. And I was just thinking, if we could just sell about 30% of that to the taxpayers of the United States, just sell 30% of that, we could probably get rid of our debt.
We'd retire.
Our $16 trillion in debt, if we could just sell about 30% of that. You know, but, you know, that I don't know whether that'll ever come to pass under this current administration. I'm sure it won't come to pass, but maybe we can get it done one of these days. But thank you, I appreciate all of your being here and you know, holding the session and enlightening people about what's going on. Thank you.
You know, Senator Burton must have known about Jefferson, because that's exactly what Jefferson did when he was president, and he paid off half the national debt. Andrew Jackson did the rest of it by selling public land, and Jackson had $28 million left over. He gave it back to the states.
Well, I'm not going to take up any more time, but I don't want to get into it in the state, but we have some in the state that we could get rid of, and we could probably reduce our deficit by a whole lot just in the state if we could get rid of some of our holdings here. And believe me, I've talked to them about that time and time again, but, you know, there's all kind of problems.
Would that be so we can generate lots more
debt? So anyway, you know, we're going to do this, we're going to do that.
Just not keep spending.
Yeah, thank you.
Letter A. He began studying Latin, Greek, and French at the age of 9. At 16, he entered college. At 18, he graduated. I like to read this sentence. During a 5-year period, he often studied 12 to 14 hours a day. Okay. 2 or 3 hours of homework. 12 to 14 hours a day. I mean, he just had to know it, and he did. And under letter B, he gained proficiency in 5 languages. He studied the Greek classics. He studied the Roman classics. He studied European history. And he was a great student of the Bible. Most people don't understand that about Jefferson, but he was. And he knew the Bible. He also knew British history. Number 6 is British history. He was a great student of the Old Testament, and he and others in their studies of the Old Testament realized that when they studied how Moses set up the government of ancient Israel, which we'll describe a little in detail after our morning break here, what they were looking at was the most efficient form of representative government. That's your blank, top of page 11, representative government. Someone interviewed Jefferson and wrote of his interview, and here's what this fellow said about Jefferson under letter C. When he spoke of law, I thought he was a lawyer. When he talked about mechanics, I was sure he was an engineer. When he got into medicine, it was evident he was a physician. When he discussed theology, I was convinced he must be a clergyman. When he talked of literature, I made up my mind I'd run against a college professor who knew everything. That's how impressed he was with Jefferson.
Well, you know, one of the questions that was debated before 1776 in America was this, and this surprises some people. Are we good enough for freedom? What does that presuppose? What does that indicate they believed? If you say, are we good enough for freedom, that must mean you believe you have to be good and virtuous to be free. I said that in a Sunday school class one time. I was in Kentucky. They invited me to stay over and go to church. And I went to the Sunday school class of the students that I teach, 16, 17-year-old. So they invited me to say something, so I talked about freedom. I said, you know, you have to be good to be free. And there was a young man sitting over on the edge. And I must admit, I stereotyped a little bit. And the way he was dressed and so forth, it looked to me like he might have a little hard time being good. And he took issue with me.
He says, what do you mean I have to be good to be free? I'm sure they want a free country, isn't it? I got my rights.
So we had a little discussion about what happens to your freedom if you're not good. That's pretty easy to show. And the founders believed you have to have a certain level, what they call public virtue. There's a quote in here. Madison, is there enough public virtue in this country for us to be free? And that was the discussion. And there were some who said, no, we're not there yet. And there were others who said, well, we're not, may not be there, but we better break. And so this guy comes over, Thomas Paine, from Europe, and he writes this little book called Common Sense, which is your blank for letter A, and in it he says, you don't think you're ready for freedom yet? Let me tell you what's happening in England. England is going down, and if you don't get off the boat, you're going to go down with it. And that was the little spark that did it, and that's why they decided, you know, we'll go for it. So, letter B, on March the 17th, Washington's forces liberated Boston. I wish I could take the time to tell you that story. That's another one of those miracle stories that happened. You ought to look it up if you don't know it. Letter C, May the 4th, Rhode Island jumped the gun and declared freedom all by herself. That's kind of Rhode Island, right? On May the 10th, Congress authorized each colony to set up its own government. May the 14th, Jefferson arrives in Philadelphia as a delegate to Congress, but he doesn't want to be there. Where does Jefferson want to be? He's got work to do in Virginia. And he actually requested that he be dismissed from Congress to go back home. Can you imagine somebody doing that today? I've got to go help Georgia. Can I leave this place and go back? And if his request would have been granted, what wouldn't he have written?
Declaration.
As it was, his request was denied. You're blank for letter F. On June the 7th, Richard Henry Lee stands and makes his famous resolution that they be free and independent. And John June the 7th. And John Hancock says, we're not going to take a vote on this right now. We're going to take a recess. You go back home and make sure you know how your state wants you to vote on this issue, because this is for all the marbles, right? And so that's what they did. Meanwhile, on June the 11th, a committee was appointed to write a declaration. And it had five people on it, three of which you see in the picture, Franklin, Adams, and Jefferson. And here's a little dialogue under letter A, written by John Adams, between him and Jefferson about who should write the declaration. You've all been on committees, haven't you, of one sort or another? And you know that in the final analysis, it kind of has to go through one brain, right? The writing, okay? Whose brain is it going to go through, Jefferson or Adams? So this is the kind of little interesting little conversation. He says, Jefferson proposed to me to make the draft. I said, I will not. You should do it. Jefferson, oh no, why will you not? You ought to do it. Adams, I will not. Does this sound like Adams? Jefferson, why? Adams, reasons enough. Reasons enough. It's a very formal New England talk, right? Reasons enough. What would we say here in Georgia? When somebody asks you why, you just say,
said so.
Just because. Right? Reasons enough. Jefferson, what could be your reasons?
I love it.
Adams, reason first. You are a Virginian, and a Virginian ought to appear at the head of this business. Remember, it's the biggest state and so forth. Reason second. I am obnoxious, suspected, and unpopular. And the question was he?
Yes.
Yes. And he knew it. Here was a great soul. But, you know, he was so direct and so insistent at times that even he knew that he rubbed people the wrong way. But that was John Adams. And I tell you, in some cases, we needed that. And he was there. But we haven't really appreciated John Adams until... who was it? David McCullough wrote his book, and then HBO and all that. Anyway, it's kind of interesting. He says, you are very much otherwise, Tom. Reason third, you can write 10 times better than I can. I don't know about that. Adams was a great writer. But anyway, so Jefferson says, well, if you are decided, I will do as well as I can. That's how Jefferson came to write the Declaration. So he worked on it for 17 days. Now, you know the Declaration has two paragraphs at the beginning. How does it start?
When in the course of human events comes...
When in the course of human events, the second paragraph?
We hold these truths.
That's filled with gold nuggets of
natural political wisdom,
I'll tell you what. We hold these truths to be self-evident. And then there's a big, long list. What's the list?
The grievances.
Grievances against the king. Have you read them lately? Sound familiar, many of them, anyway. And that takes up most of the Declaration. Then there's a concluding paragraph and the signatures. And how long did Jefferson take to write the list of grievances? One day. That's your blank for number one. One day. He actually already had it written in another document it mentions there. So it's a matter of copying it. The question is, what was he doing the other 16 days? And the answer is, he was writing the first two paragraphs. You young people, 16 days to write two paragraphs?
Constructing the rationale.
Yeah. He wanted to make sure that he was incorporating what he called the ancient principles into this document. Did he do it? Draft after draft after draft. Yes, he did. Brilliant. And so your blank for C at the top of 13 is 2. Did you get that?
It's so brilliant, people can't understand it.
Let's go through the eight principles in the Declaration briefly here. We'll do this before we take a little morning break. First of all, that sound government should be based on self-evident truths. What is a self-evident truth?
Natural law.
Yeah, you don't have to discuss it, not to argue. It's so evident. You know, I don't know what it's like outside, but usually in Arizona we can say the sun is shining. That's pretty self-evident.
It also allowed him not to have to prove anything said.
Yeah. I mean, there's no debate, among which is there is a creator. You find no debate among the founders whether there's a creator or not. That's self-evident. Amazing. Okay, number two, the government of mankind here on earth should be based on the law of nature and of nature's God. We've already talked about that, natural law. Okay. Number three, this presupposes, as a self-evident truth, that the creator made human beings equal. Well, are we all equal in every way?
No.
So what does that mean? This means we are to be treated equally in three ways, and here they are, in our rights, before the bar of justice, in other words, by the law, and, of course, in the sight of God. All other ways, we are unequal. Number four, these rights, which have been bestowed by the Creator on each individual, are inalienable. What's an inalienable right? Given by
God, the
Creator, which man has no authority to take. And if man does, he will answer to him who gave those rights. Okay, that's an inalienable right. Now, you know we have other rights that are not inalienable. Did you know that? For example,
contract rights.
the right to a trial by jury. That's not an inalienable right. It wasn't given by the Creator. It's developed actually by government, mostly Anglo-Saxon, by the way, as the best way in a court of law to protect the inalienable rights of the people. We call these vested rights. And vested rights can be changed by government, but not inalienable. So we have inalienable rights and vested rights. Okay? Yes.
Well, that trial by jury brings up a very important question. If all human beings have an equal right, and one of those rights is the right to life, liberty, and property, or a set of three of those rights are those rights, then how can any government take that away, even following a trial? If you believe in natural rights, why is it a right of the government to strip somebody of their freedom and their by putting them in a jail cell, taking away their property, or even putting them in front of a firing squad or making them drop through the gallows for a crime?
Because of the right of other people not to have their rights infringed upon, and if somebody does infringe upon their rights, they do it at the peril of their rights. That's, for example, that's a law of God. He gave this to Noah. He who sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed.
Genesis chapter 10.
So
civil society is not free to modify natural rights. We look back to the rule of God and make our laws in accordance to what's written.
Well said.
Yes.
Well said.
Mr. Taylor, 34% of the Constitution is based upon the Bible. 34%.
34% of the quotes of the founding fathers in deliberating it. The whole thing is based on the Word of God.
Right.
34% of all of the references were from the Bible.
Okay, so we have two kinds of rights, vested and inalienable. Number five, and one of the most important of the inalienable rights, as you know, is the right to life, liberty, and the right to pursue whatever course you decide will lead to your happiness as long as you do not invade the rights of others. Others as you blank, which is what we just said.
Redistribution of wealth.
Which includes redistribution of wealth, because that invades the rights of others,
yes.
Right? And I tell my young people, I say, this is real freedom. When you can do anything you want to do, anything, as long as you don't invade the rights of other people, that's real freedom. And then I usually say, after a little pause, I don't know that any of us really know what real freedom is. They look at me like, we don't in this free country? Say, well, we're so used to the regulations, the controls. We've grown up with them. Not sure you know what real freedom is. I just let that sit until we talk about the next one here, number six. The most basic reason for a community or a nation to set up a system of government is to assure that its inhabitants, that their rights shall be protected and preserved. Now, lest we don't give that full impact, I want to give a couple of examples here by asking some questions. Let me ask you this question. Do I have the right to stand in the doorway of my home with a loaded weapon day and night to protect my home against invasion? Is that right?
Yes.
As somebody said the other day, still. Have that right. Do I have the right to stand out on my yard with my garden hose day and night, if I want to protect my home against fire? Do I have that right?
Yeah.
Yes. Do I want to do those things?
No.
What do I want to do? I want to get some sleep. I want to come to Georgia. I want to teach school. I want to be with my... There's a lot of things I want to do rather than this. And my neighbors basically feel the same way. So what do? We combine in a community our resources and we go down to Joe, nice, strong young man down the street, and say, Joe, how would you like to work for us? Well, doing what?
Well, you know, each of us could stand in our doorway, but that's a little inefficient. We want to hire you to do it, and we want to authorize you to do it and delegate to you the authority that we have to do it, because we have it, and we're going to evidence that authority by a badge. We're going to give you a gun and authorize you to use it because we can. We're going to buy you a car, put some lights on, and just have you drive around our neighborhood. Will you do that? Joey says, I think I can do that. We go to Sam down the street over here and say, Sam, how would you like to work for us? We're going to buy you a big truck, put a big tank on it, paint it red, get you a big long hose and a big hat and big coat and big boots. And if we call you, please hurry, because our house will be on fire. Make sure that tank is always full of water. And he says, I think I can do that. So I ask you folks, what have we just created here? We call it a police and a fire, but what is it really? One word starts with a G. Government. It's the delegation of authority that we have as individuals to do for us what we could do for ourselves. But for efficiency's sake, we have delegated it to others to do it for us. That's all government is. Well, that's all government should be, according to the founders. Yes, sir.
In the cases you just mentioned, could those also be considered private services provided by, since you're paying them anyway, I mean, could it also be free enterprise?
Yes.
As opposed to...
And a lot of governments rely on private services to do that. Some
right.
Yeah. However you decide to do it. But the main thing to remember, it's a delegation of authority. Okay? Now let me give you another example. I live here. The Jones family lives on this side of me. The Smith family lives on this side of me. I'm in the middle. And over time, I noticed quite a disparity here. The Jones family, big family, I guess he has a hard time making a living. I don't know what the deal is, but anyway, they don't even have a car. And that's pretty tough nowadays. Over here, the Smiths, and there's only two of them, and they have two cars. And I noticed that they only drive one. The other one just kind of seems to be extra, because it's always sitting there. Now I'm in the middle. By now that you know, I'm a very compassionate and merciful person. And this, over time, this inequity begins to bother me. The struggling Jones family, the opulence of the Smith family. So I finally get up enough courage to give Mr. Smith a suggestion. Mr. Smith, have you noticed the plight of the Jones family? And we review it, and he says, yeah, it's pretty bad. I said, yeah. I have a suggestion for you, Mr. Smith. You know that extra car you've got? Why don't you go give it to Mr. Jones? He says, well, thank you for the suggestion. I said, well, actually, I insist. This really should be done. Get out of here, he says. I come back home, I'm pretty dejected. He would be so hard-hearted, being the compassionate person that I am, right? And after a while, this continues to bother me to the point where I can't even sleep one night. And around midnight, I get up and I say, well, I'm gonna do something. So I go, and I'm a good mechanic too. So I go over to this car, this extra car that Mr. Jones has sitting here, and I hotwire that car, and I drive it over to Mr. Jones, and I knock on his door, and Mr. Jones, I have something for you. You do? Yeah, a car. It's all yours. Well, thank you. I made a friend, and I wish I had a key, Mr. Jones, but if you just touch these two wires, and so I just come home, I just feel so good about it, being the compassionate person that I am, and I sleep so soundly until the next morning, I get a knock at the door, and I open the door, and there stands the sheriff. He says, your fingerprints are all over that car. Well, of course, you'd do the same thing if you were as compassionate as I am. Well, you could tell that to the judge. So I'm arrested, I'm hauled in, it's pretty obvious. I'm convicted, this is serious business. This is grand larceny. And I gotta spend a couple of years in the pokey. And while I'm in there, I say, you know, there ought to be a better way to do this. So I developed this little idea, and when I get out, which I eventually do, I go to all the neighbors, well, except for Mr. Smith, go to all the neighbors,
And I get them all worked up about the plight of the Jones and this extra over here, the Smiths. And I start passing a petition around to get the question on the next ballot if the Smiths should give their extra car to the Jones. And I get enough signature to get it on the ballot. And now comes the election, and we're good campaigners. And we get all these people worked up about the suffering of the Jones family. And the election comes, and guess what? We win by a majority, by a majority. This is great democracy in action, right? By a majority. Now it's public law that the Smiths must give their car to the Jones, public law, to be enforced by the sheriff. Let's talk about it. I want you to help me get down to the very basic issue here. What is it?
That's what's going on right now.
Number seven.
Democracy is not as good as the Constitution.
Yeah, these are all right. May I suggest this? The very basic concept is this. Number one, the only place where the power to govern exists inherently from the Creator is with individuals. There is no other place government inherently has power, except it is delegated by individual, because it rests with individual. That's an inalienable right to govern oneself, right? Okay? And you can only delegate something that you have. You cannot delegate authority to government that you don't have. And if I don't have the authority as an individual to take a car from Mr. Smith and give it to Mr. Jones, if it would be a crime for me to do it, then I cannot delegate that authority to my agent, the government, to do it for me.
Thank you.
And if the government does, what do we call that? One word, starts with a U, the founders used this word. Usurpation. They have usurped authority they do not have.
Which is the essence of tyranny.
Yep. And then government gets out of control. That was so basic to the founders' philosophy, and it is so disregarded today. Have you noticed in almost every level of government, people think if they get elected, they can do anything for which they can get a majority on their, in their legislature, in Congress, on their city council, wherever, school board, wherever. As long as they have a majority, they can do it. And the founders would say, no, you must first have legitimate delegated authority to do it. Mm-hmm. See that concept?
Yeah, that's the Constitution.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Which delegates very limited
Correct.
Power.
Enumerated.
Yeah, yes, sir.
So we can't tell our neighbor that we don't want him to fly a flag, but we can get together and have our county commission pass a law saying nobody's going to raise a flagpole or a flag in a residential neighborhood.
Right.
We can't tell our neighbor that he can't cut his own hair in his own family. Wife cuts husband's hair, husband cuts wife's hair. But we can make a law that says the state of Georgia will license barbers, and you can't cut somebody else's hair unless you hold that license.
See, we got problems there, don't we?
In addition to those, let me give you some other examples. I live in the deserts of Arizona, and there's a lot of swimming pools in backyards, for obvious reasons. And with a lot of swimming pools come tragedy, once in a while. And it is tragic. Young child falls in, drowned, and so forth. A number of years ago, a well-meaning senator in our state legislature introduced a bill to make it a state law to fence your pool. And she had it all detailed, a certain kind of fence right around the pool, certain gates, certain locking mechanism. I mean, it was all spelled out. So I asked my students, okay, if you were in the legislature, how would you decide on how you're going to vote on this kind of a bill? And I suggest that they take it to the very simplest by saying, okay, let's pretend there's only two people on the earth, you and I, and you're building a swimming pool. Can I come over to your place and say, I require you to fence your pool? I don't have the authority to do that. Then how can I delegate that authority to my agent, the government, to make you do it? Yeah, that's pretty simple, isn't it?
technically you can, but it happens.
Well, yeah. Here's another one. Do I have the authority as an individual to tell you, to make you, buckle up?
No.
I don't have that authority. Here's another one. Do I have the authority, related to what you said, to tell my neighbor he has to get my permission for him to be a plumber? I don't have that authority, but you know he does. He has to get permission of my agent, the government, to be a plumber. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, these things relate to what I told these students. I'm not sure you know what real freedom is. Because we've let these things grow almost to the point of even some of our good friends will say, oh, that's pretty radical what you're saying. But I'm telling you, this is real freedom. And if we restore this freedom, there would be ways in which people's safety and so forth would be protected probably more than they are now.
Yeah.
When you think about it. But it takes some thought. Anyway, if this is the first time some of you have heard of this, I just want us to think about real freedom. And it's amazing what will happen. Can you believe all this is in the Declaration of Independence? It is. Yes, sir.
You know, the Bible talks about a parapet around your roof. And in American law, we have a word called attractive nuisance. And given that adults have a greater capacity than little children to perceive danger, I really do believe in the example of the state senator that I think she was right, that when you have an attractive nuisance, an open well, a pool, vacant old mansion, that adults should secure that for the protection of youth and others.
Now don't get me wrong, you should buckle up. And you should. Because this goes back to the question of virtue and morality.
But is it should or shall? In public law, is it a should or do we make it a shall?
And if you do create a nuisance and someone is injured by it, you may be held liable. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying, you know, if you live in a community, you have a certain obligation as a community member to not create a nuisance. But to have all of these laws and regulations thinking that it's legitimate to tell people what they can and can't do, and admittedly, these things, you know, there's a fine line between what we should do and what we should do, what we must do. Senator.
Well, you think most of this stuff is common sense, you know. If I don't want to buckle up, and I fought the buckle up laws for quite a while, because I didn't want them to tell me what to do about riding in my vehicle and buckling up. But that particular law, if I get thrown out of my vehicle because I didn't buckle up, that affects me. That kills me. But I passed a law here a couple of years ago, 2-3 years ago, no texting while driving. And the reason I passed that law is because that law is going to kill me.
Right.
You know, it might not kill that person who's texting, but they can kill me. So, you know, we had that. And you'd think that most of this stuff is just common sense. You know, but it's not. If you, like you're talking about with a swimming pool, it's probably a Democrat that broke that law. But if you got a swimming pool out there and you're in a neighborhood that just has kids running all over the place, you know, and that's probably why that law became in existence. But there again, if I had a pool, I don't want to be liable for somebody getting drowned. So should I go out there and lock it up? That should be my responsibility. But we've got a lot of dumb people that they don't exercise those responsibilities.
This goes back to religion and morality, because if the Second Commandment says, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, you would want to be as protective of your neighbors. Not because you're made to, but because that's your belief.
Right.
You treasure their lives as you do your own. That's why this foundation of morality and virtue is so critical. It takes the place of a lot of stuff that would otherwise come from a tyrannical, regulated society.
The laws are made for the worst offenders.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
The way that homeowners associations function, should government enforce and allow homeowners associations to violate the rights of other people within the neighborhood? In your opinion, because I'm not really sure how all that works anyway. Maybe that's out of the scope of all of this. But in the pool thing made me think about it. Maybe that would be more appropriate if a homeowners association were to be approached about something like that. Then they could say, we hereby decree that all pools shall have fences around them in our neighborhood.
The important thing to know is you have a right to contract. And if you buy a home in an area that's governed by certain CCNRs, deed restrictions, and so forth, and you agree to abide by those,
it's their private property rights.
That's a legitimate thing that you've agreed to do, whether it's to paint your house a certain color, or fix your pool, or whatever. You agree to that, but that's all private. And those private agreements should be able to be enforced. That's why people rely on them. But see, that's not government coming in and saying after the fact you have to do this and this and this. And this. Yeah. See the difference there?
But the homeowner association is almost that way. Even if you don't want to enter into a contract, you have no choice.
It's a form of government.
I know, yeah. HOAs can get out of hand too, but just remember, you have a right to contract, you have a right to protect yourself, but contracts, you need to remember, if you're trying to force people to do things after they've already bought into it, see, there's a problem there. That's not what their agreement was. Some people don't even read HOA agreements before they buy into it.
Right.
That's a problem. But
that's your problem.
That's more, that's your problem. If you take the initiative and the decision-making off of individuals, then they become dull to having to be sharp and aware of things. This is a problem. This is a problem with product safety in this country. We have become so used to the government making sure that everything we buy is safe, and so we're kind of oblivious to any problem that might happen.
See, this is consequences.
Yeah, this is not right, and it makes us a people dependent on government. And the founders would say, no. Depend on government to protect the rights of the people, not to protect them from every little danger that may come along. Anyway, let me finish this, and then we'll take a break. Number seven, because this is so, it follows that no office or agency of government has any right to exist except with the consent of the people. Consent. And number eight, it follows that if a government, either by malfeasance or neglect, fails to protect these rights, or even worse, if the government itself begins to violate these rights, then it is the right and duty of the people to regain control of their affairs and set up a form of government that will serve the people better. And there is the justification. And I just need to say this. Aren't we glad that every 2 years we can do that?
Yes.
Do you realize what we can do every 2 years in this country if we wanted to? We could change nearly every member of every state legislature.
And we should.
We could change every member of the House of Representatives in Washington. We could change one-third the Senate every 2 years. And every other 2 years, do all that again. Another third the Senate, the President, if we want to badly enough. This is what we call peaceful self-repair. But it takes an educated electorate who knows our rights, who knows these very basic principles to be able to do that. That's our challenge, isn't it? Yeah. Don't you think the founders would have loved to have gotten rid of King George at the ballot box? I think so. But they didn't have the system. They gave us the system. We need to learn it. We need to popularize it. That's our challenge. Declaration of Independence. Well, let's see. I think I've mentioned it. Let's take a 10-minute...
We have a
letter
D.
Letter D, did you get that?
How many changes?
Oh, 60. Let's take a 10-minute break here, and then we'll come back.